Morning, guys. Good to see you all this morning. If you would and are able, please stand. And if you would, please bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing us here together today, Lord. And just please be with us as we sing these songs, Lord, and we lift you up. And just please be with us. Please be with Brother Rick as he brings a message. And please be with all those who couldn't be here today for whatever reason. All these things are actually so precious. Amen. Our first song today, guys, is Grateful. And the second song will be The Lord Our God. And then we're going to do a special.
We'll be right back.
for your glory. Yes, we can know you are good. Yes, we can know you are good. Lord, our God is never faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness, you will lead us. Forever we will say, you're the Lord our God. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all. Be seated. Feel special for our last song. This song is called My Story. If I told you my story, you would hear hope, but wouldn't let go. And if I told you my story, you would hear love that never gave up. If I told you my story, you would hear life, but it wasn't mine. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served. And where mercy went, of the kindness of Jesus draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of it. If I told you my story, you would hear victory over the enemy. And if I told you my story, you would hear freedom that was won for me. And if I told you my story, you would hear life overcome. If I should speak, justice was served, and where mercy went, of the kindness of Jesus, it draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of the grace that is greater.
Let's first turn to the Word of God. I'm going to read Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now, if you would, please bow your head. Father, thank you for this reading of your word, this very familiar text that so many of us hold so dear to our hearts, that proclaims not just the position of Christ in favor with you, but the favor that we have in Christ for ourselves. I pray, God, that we would lay hold of this truth and it would press our souls toward a greater worship. We ask it and we pray it in Christ's name. Amen. Well, start off with our catechism question, number 46. What is the Lord's Supper? Christ commanded all Christians to eat bread and to drink from the cup in thankful remembrance of him and his death. The Lord's Supper is a celebration of presence of God in our midst, bringing us into communion with God and with one another, feeding and nourishing our souls. It also anticipates the day when we will eat and drink with Christ in his Father's kingdom. The unfortunate part is this is a huge dividing line in the body of Christ. It ought not be. We have liberty. That's like the number of times we take it per year. There are some that insist that it must be done every Sunday. There's really no merit for that. Neither is there merit to say, well, it must only be done quarterly, or it must only be done monthly, or it has to be done biweekly. That's where liberty comes in. The unfortunate part is Christians will divide about this when what it's meant to do is bring unity to the body of Christ. That's what it should do. Well, let's look at our announcements. Wyatt Carwell will be baptized during our 11 o'clock service this morning. Please remember him and his Christian walk in your prayers. There will be an Easter breakfast planning meeting following both services today. There will be a deacon's meeting immediately following the 11 o'clock service today. The Young at Heart will meet Wednesday, March 6th at 11 a.m. with a potluck meal at noon. On Wednesday, the RAs, GAs, Youth, Mission Friends, and Adult Bible Study will take place at 7. The week of prayer for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering is March 3rd to the 10th. Our offering goal is $300. It's a very modest goal. And you may designate on your check or there are envelopes in the offering plates. This offering goes to help missionaries who are serving in North America. We send missionaries everywhere. These are the ones that are going to be in North America. Our monthly business meeting is next week after 11 o'clock service. If you have any old Sunday school literature or VBS material that you would like to get rid of, please drop it off in the church office. It will be donated to BookLink International, an organization that collects Sunday school literature and sends it to Africa. The food pantry is in need of the following items, and you can read those. We're accepting donations of gloves, scarves, and hats for girls and boys for Operation Christmas Child during the month of March. And then happy birthday to Lydia Heck, March 3rd, to Emma Gleaner, March 7th, and then Hope Lauterbach, March 9th. I believe that's got our announcements. Okay, and with that, brother, would you come up and we'll get ready to take our tithes and offerings. And would you lead us in prayer, please?
Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, Lord, for blessings that you bestow upon us. And Lord, each week we receive blessings of your glory and your strength. And Father, as we receive some of these blessings, we also give some of these blessings back. We ask, Lord, that you would please bless this offering, that we may use it to do your will. Amen.
Amen. Well, now if we can come up for our children's church then, please. I'll ask you now if you will turn into your Bibles. We will finish up chapter 1 of John We're going to look at verses 43 to 51 today. There's a certain sense at which we we are doing the same thing people have been doing for the last 2,000 years. And I think it's actually kind of come back around to being more similar to a first and second century Christianity, not necessarily in our doctrinal views. I think that should be pretty close to what they believed because they didn't have the time to sit down and develop it for fear of being murdered, but they were following Christ. We enjoyed, the church that is, enjoyed certain favor because we were brought up in this country, and in this country we had actually quite a bit of favor shown to the church. That's starting to become not the case. And as it becomes not the case, we're getting a greater sense of what the church actually experiences worldwide. Much of the church is a persecuted church. Now, when we say we've been persecuted, we just mean that the people aren't as receptive as they once were. We just don't have an inroads anymore. But I'm not sure that's necessarily all that bad. As we look at the church, I see people very concerned because the numbers are down. Well, that's true, but I'm not sure that the true numbers are actually any further down than they ever were. We had a lot of people that were coming to church because it was culturally correct to do so, but they had no fealty to Christ. They had no fidelity to Christ. They had no love of the Lord Jesus. They simply came to church because it's what you did, which may or may not be connected to a saving and true faith. What we're seeing now is a church more akin to what it was in the beginning, which is a church that stands opposed to the world. Now, it's truthful that the world has always opposed the church. They just tolerated it differently. And in our day, they seem to, again, be tolerating it just a bit less than they once did. When I grew up, the church was thought to hold a high position. We held the pastors and the deacons and the church officers in high esteem. That seems not to be the case. Now everybody's an expert in everything, and therefore they don't need anybody to tell them how to do anything. And that really puts us in a bit of a bind, if you will. And we see the church reacting today differently than they did just some years ago, just a few years ago even. And I think we'll find that today when we look at this text. What Jesus is calling you to is the same thing he was calling his disciples in that day. A disciple's just a learner. To live a life that is marked out by the following of Christ. And if it's not marked out by the following of Christ, then it calls into question its validity. So many today want to say, well, I'm a Christian, but there's just no evidence of it. The problem is there's never been in the history of the church that form of Christianity. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was right when he said that that's cheap grace, this idea that, well, you can be saved, but there's no evidence of it in your life. That's cheap grace. That's not real grace. Real grace always makes a change. It always alters the life being lived. It simply can't do anything else. It has to change your course, because if you're following Christ, you've changed your course. So with that bit of an intro, let's look at our text, which is John chapter 1, verse 43 to 51. Let's read it together. Let's do me a favor. I've mentioned it before. I'm going to ask you if you would stand for the reading of the Word of God. I think that's the right thing to do, and I think we've let it go, and I think it's a mistake. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said to him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, How do you know me? Jesus answered him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Please bow your heads with me. Father, having now heard your word, I would beg of you that you would give us ears to hear. And Lord, that having heard the word, that it might then penetrate into our souls, as Hebrews 4:12 says it would. And that it penetrates into our soul and it does exactly what you intend. It makes us something different than we were when we walked in the door. I pray, God, for not only this converting power, but this cleansing power for the saints of God. We ask, God, your blessing upon both the reading and the proclamation of your word. We do it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. So I want to start with those two little words, follow me. Now, when he says follow me, he doesn't sit down and provide this whole big long discourse. He walks up to people, and it's actually Jesus' habit to walk up to somebody in the middle of doing their life, which is exactly what he did to you. If you're converted today, he walked up to you in the middle of your life and said, follow me. When he says follow me, he doesn't go through this whole diatribe about, okay, now stop doing what you're doing and follow me. But what he means is everything about you is going to be changed. When you follow me really, when you follow me truly, that following changes everything about you. It alters your course completely. All of mankind is headed into an everlasting condemnation, except that they should be interrupted by the Lord Jesus Christ and his saving grace. And when we're headed straight into our judgment and grace grabs us, it always changes us. So when Jesus says those simple words, follow me, he doesn't just mean in every way you'd like. Much of the church is suffering today because we've taken on that idea. You can follow me where you'd like to, and where you don't want to, don't worry about that. That's not true. That's not real Christianity. Real Christianity is follow me no matter the cost. We've seen thousands of brothers and sisters that go to be crucified, torn asunder, sawn in half. Every other kind of torture that you can have for being a follower of the Lord Jesus. So they followed him to the very end, no matter its cost. Jesus is pretty plain about this. He walks up to people and says, follow me. And he seems to expect that what you're going to do is, if you're mending nets, to just drop them and walk off. You remember what he says about those people that say, well, look, I will follow you, but first let me, I've just recently been married. Let me go say goodbye to my wife and take care of the time with my new bride. Or even this, let me go bury my father, which is, by the way, a great obligation inside of Israel. You're to take care of and bury your father, honoring him because he's your father. And yet Jesus says to that man, let the dead bury the dead. What he's saying is the course that I'm setting you on is so completely different, so other, that it'll look as though you've walked off into a whole other place, a whole other world. And that's exactly what takes place. When a person is redeemed, when they are born from above, their physical outsides don't change. They look just like they did. Now, what ought to change is their facial structure a little bit. They ought to be everlastingly happy because they're headed towards an everlasting contentment, everlasting blessedness, and that should leak its way into our faces, and yet that's not often the case. A lot of people will say, well, I'm following Jesus, but I'm kind of telling him where to go. Hey, Jesus, up here, take a right, and then make a left, and then go straight down that way. That's not Christianity of any form. There are a lot of people today that want to say, well, Jesus, look, I'll take over, you follow me now. That's not part of the deal. There's one Lord and Master, and it's not you. and it's not me. And we are called to follow him wherever he goes. He says things that the world looks at and goes, man, what is this guy want from you? Pick up your cross and follow after me? Crosses aren't just things of artwork, they're things to die upon. What he's saying is give up doing what you're doing and come do what I'm doing. Walk away. Much like Abraham. Walk away from everything that's familiar to you and follow me that I might display all my promises in you. Because in Christ they are yea and amen, right? So that's real Christianity. The problem is we're bumping up against a lot of Christianity that's iffy Christianity at best. It says things like, well, Jesus wants me to be happy. I invite you to find one verse that actually says that. Just one. It's not a big weight for you to carry. Now, there is a certain sense in which you can be content, and happiness does come, but not as the chief pursuit. You pursue Christ, and you get contentment, and you get happiness. But if you pursue happiness, you'll never follow Christ. People who want to say, well, I just want to be happy. That's the normal thing. Most people want to be happy. There's a few people out there that don't want to be happy. That's strange. That's a little odd. That's peculiar. But when you aim for happy, what you always end up with is discontented. And what you won't get is discipleship in Christ. You won't get following after Jesus. What Jesus says, aim at me and I'll give you everything else. Follow me. That's a big deal, man. It is, in fact, all of Christianity summed up in two little words. Real Christianity is following Christ. Now, it has doctrinal things that matter. We believe in one God. We believe in the Trinity. We believe in the virgin birth. That's true. But in the end, Christianity is about following Jesus and doing so in such a singular way that the world knows it, that the world sees it. Not that that's the weight of our calling. Our calling is simply to follow, and the effect of real following is that the world sees it. And when they see it, they then ask, what is it that you're following? Who is it that you're following? Well, I'm following Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life by his own testimony. And I'm interested in where he's going. I'm interested in what he's doing. There's no room here for this idea that Christianity is just something I do on the weekend. It's just a Sunday morning thing. I have a Sunday morning kind of Christianity. I go to church rather regularly, at least twice a month. You know, that's an obscure thing to say. And yet, nowadays, people who go twice a month are considered regular attenders. The regular attenders used to be they came to every Sunday morning and likely whatever else the church was doing. But now if you have somebody show up twice a month, they're calling that regular attendance. So when Jesus says, follow me, what he's saying is give up on all that you have. And that all that you have and all that you give away will be replaced by something better. That's actually the promise. Now, when I say better, don't fill in the better with the things you and I might think about, because that's a false gospel. That gospel says, follow Jesus, he'll make you rich. Follow Jesus, he'll make you healthy. Follow Jesus, he'll make you smarter, better looking, whatever it is that people chase after. What Jesus says is, follow me. I'll make you clean. I'll make you able to walk into the presence of the Father and not be consumed. Follow me and be my disciple. Follow me and follow me in all that I say. Right? If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. We were looking last week, and one of the ladies came up and said, you know, I didn't see the Super Bowl, and you were talking about this, you know, Jesus gets us campaign. And I said that was not a Christian thing at all. Jesus does get us. He knows us to be sinners in such a state of rebellion that we need to be born from above to move us away from that. And that our hearts are nothing but wickedness in our unconverted state. And that what we need is a Savior who is perfect, a Savior who is both God and man, a Savior who leads us to repentance, a Savior who doesn't just give me the forgiveness of sins and then says, now you just go and do whatever you want and I'll see you at the end because I'll be waiting there for you. No, what he says is, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. In other words, I'll be with you all the time, even to the end of the age. He sends his Holy Spirit to dwell in those that are his. And if you don't have the Holy Spirit, then you're none of his, says the Bible. So having the Holy Spirit, he says, now follow me. And I'm not only doing that, I'm giving you, and I hate to use this phrase, I'm giving you this holy GPS, if you will, this Holy Spirit that in conjunction with the Holy Word of God guides us and directs us that we might live in a way that is Christ-honoring and is the life that God intends for us, right? So when Jesus says, follow me there in verse 43, look at what he says in verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip. By the way, this is just no accident. We look at our lives and think they're just all accidents, things happening. And well, on our side, it is a bit of that because I don't plan everything out. I really can't. I'm not in that kind of control of my life. You aren't either. But on God's side, he's arranging things so that you run into this person and you run into that person, that they should get a sense of your call in Christ always, no matter what it is and how it is we interact with them. But Jesus walks up to Philip, says, follow me. Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Look at the effect of Jesus saying, follow me, upon Philip. Philip found Nathanael, said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote. This Jesus is not something that just pops up in the New Testament. He's not just a New Testament thing. The whole of the Bible points towards Jesus. That's confirmed to us by Luke 16, verses 14 to 17, and Luke 24, 27. Let me read those. I'm just going to read Luke 24, 27, and Luke 16 is much the same. Luke 24, 27 says this, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them all the scriptures, in all the scriptures, the things concerning him. All the scriptures. You find Jesus in Genesis, as early as chapter 3 even, where in the fall, God promises he will send one whom the evil one will strike his heel, but one whose heel will crush the evil one's head. That's the first mention of the gospel. And in that first mention of the gospel, it's all about Jesus. Jesus is not a second thought for God about how he's going to redeem a people. There are people that are trying to find other ways and trying to say, well, I know God's got Jesus there in case I need him, but I think I found this other way. Brothers and sisters, there's no other way. There's no other way except through Jesus to the Father. You cannot come to the Father unless you come through the way the Father has designed, and that's through his own Son, Jesus Christ. So the effect of Jesus saying, follow me, to Philip, was he immediately went and said, this is the guy that we've been looking for from the beginning. This is the one. This is the one whom all of the Bible tells us about. There are people that want to do things like say, well, we're a New Testament church. We start with Matthew and we move forward from there. And they throw away so much of God's word, which is ridiculous. I read Psalm 23 earlier. The way God blesses you is through Christ in that way. If you don't have Christ, he can't bless you in the way that Psalm 23 is laid out. He can't and won't. But the effect on Philip is, this is the one that God has been testifying to us about ever since the beginning. This is the one who has come to be our Messiah. He is the one that Moses spoke of and all the prophets. So when he says, follow me, he didn't say, follow me in whatever way suits you. See, that's where the problem enters in. So many want to say, well, I'll follow you, but just don't go anywhere I don't want to go. And don't do anything I don't want to do. Just do these things. You know, I've seen people that have been in the church for years. And their habits and things they still do that are marks of when they were lost. They haven't followed Christ into a purification of those things because they stubbornly won't. I've seen people who say, well, I'm following Jesus, just not where he goes with places that I'm uncomfortable with. I'm following him in the places I want. You understand that's not a real form of Christianity. And at the very best, it's a mutated form. It's a deformed way of following Jesus. It's not the biblical way at all. To follow Jesus is to forsake everything else. He puts it in this strange language. This strange language, which if the emphasis wasn't that I'm calling you to something so much greater, he would actually be guilty of sin. But he is, of course, not guilty of sin. When he says, you must love me more than your father, your mother, your brothers, your sisters, your children. When he says, hate them, he doesn't mean that you... If he's calling you literally to interpret that verse when he speaks that way, to hate your father and mother, then he's doing something that's against the will of God. Jesus never does that. What he's saying is the radical nature of the love that you're to have for me is to be so great that the love and all the things that you have for your parents, your children, and your brothers and sisters is to be so small in comparison to it that it might be construed as hate. He surely isn't calling you to hate anybody because you're forbidden that actually. Most particularly those whom you love because they're in your family or in your church family. He's not calling you to that. What he's calling you to is a form of love for him, a form of love for God that is so great and so true and so pure that it looks odd. It looks strange to those that are dead in sin and trespass. Well, I want to move from follow me, and I want you to hear what Nathaniel says. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Is that not how most of us entered into the kingdom, saying words not altogether different of that? Now, a lot of Christians will say, I never said that about Jesus. Well, actually, you did. You may have been raised in church like myself, and until you were converted... And until you were made part of the kingdom through the operation of the Holy Spirit, you had no great affection for Christ. You might have had some reverence for him in the sense that you were fearful of him, fearful of coming against him, but you didn't really love him. The Bible calls us to that. Now we see that Philip says to Nathanael, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathaniel, have you ever done that? Just somebody says something and you just throw one out there? The problem is this time it's recorded forever in the Word of God. Nathaniel says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? This wasn't the place that Jews were particularly fond of. Jesus is in fact called a Nazarene. And sometimes we get that confused with the Nazarite vow. He never took one. He's called the Nazarene because he comes out of Nazareth. So Nathanael just quips this. And Philip says, come and see. Now, I want to point again to the simplicity. Come and see. To a man who says, is there anything good that ever comes out of Nazareth? Is it possible that anything could come from Nazareth and be good? And Philip just says, come and see. Look for yourself. Brothers and sisters, that's as complicated as it gets when we witness to the world. Take a real look. Don't just pretend to look. Take a real look. The number of historic occasions where somebody took a real look at Jesus, trying to disprove who he was, and then coming to true and saving faith, being converted when they set out to disprove who Jesus is. The number of times they end up being a follower of Christ is amazing. I have books in my library of men that will tell you, I came here. I came here, one of them, trying to disprove his wife's faith. The Case for Christ, Lee Strobel, if you've read it. He set out to disprove who Jesus is because he's getting tired of his wife's faith. His wife's faith in Jesus was annoying him. So because she was annoying him with her following of Jesus, he decided he would sit down with some experts and look at how ridiculous this claim for, that Christ is the Messiah is, and he ends up getting converted in the pursuit of trying to prove that Jesus is in fact nobody. He's been a follower of Christ for quite some time now. His objective was to prove that Jesus isn't the Christ, that Jesus isn't God. He ends up, when he actually looked at the evidence, saying he can't be anybody else but God. He is the Christ of God. He believes the exact same thing that's being said here in this text. And he started out saying the same thing that Nathaniel said. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? That's the way a lot of people look at Jesus. Isn't he just an ancient guy he's no longer relevant? He's not popular today. How can you fix your whole life based upon the life, death, burial, and resurrection of someone who died 2,000 years ago? Well, because millions have been doing it since then. And then I'm convinced because not only the evidence, but because Christ has shown himself to me through the work of the Spirit. So you shouldn't be dissuaded from doing the work of witnessing because people say things like, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Because it was said to the earliest disciples. Really? This guy's coming out. Has anything come out of Nazareth before, guys? Has any good thing ever? Of course you know there's nothing good coming out of Nazareth. How can this guy be the Messiah? That's his point. Look at what happens. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit, or in your translation may say guile. Nathanael said to him, how do you know me? Jesus answered him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Now, let me be clear. How we interpret that little bit right there, there's a couple different ways it can go, but whatever it is, it's convincing enough that the response is this: Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. So Nathanael, who says, can any good thing come out of Israel or out of Nazareth, is now saying, you're the Son of God. You're the King of Israel. His eyes were opened. You need only look at the cases in the scriptures. I mean, you can move outside of that. There are times in the lives of all of us we've seen somebody who is not a Christ follower, who denied Jesus. Then they turn. The best case in the scriptures to me, I think, is Saul. Saul breathing out threatenings, slaughtering Christians for sport, and then getting the authority of the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin and going and dragging people out of their homes because of their testimony that Christ is the Messiah, that Jesus is the Savior. And on his way to do more damage, more harm, to be the great persecutor of the church, he's knocked off his animal and blinded by the light of Christ, who says, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Jesus understood that the persecution of his people was the persecution of him. And Saul becomes the Apostle Paul, who was an opponent, who said much more than, can anything good come out of Nazareth? He was convinced of his rightness in putting those guys to death and dragging out entire families that he might give glory to God by the abuse of these followers of Christ. And now he becomes one of them. That's the power of God to convert us. That's the power of God that takes a Saul and makes him into a Paul. In all the years of my ministry, I've seen people that come from crazy backgrounds where they're just blasphemer upon blasphemer upon blasphemer. And then something happens. The Holy Spirit, through his gracious work, brings them to true and saving faith in Jesus. And all of a sudden, the blasphemer is crying forth, "Glory to God in Jesus Christ." How is that possible? Well, it's the work of the church, but it's the work of the church through the power of the Spirit. And the Spirit can convert anybody that he desires to convert. So he has a confession. You know, we're to have a confession. We're to confess with our mouth, says the Scriptures. We're not converted by the confession with our mouth. We're converted by the work of the Holy Spirit. But once we are converted, we are to confess with our mouth and our life that Jesus is the Savior. Something similar to what's said here. Rabbi, our teacher, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. That's a good confession. Peter has a good one too, Matthew 16. You are the Son of God. You are the Christ of God. Yeah, that's true. And Jesus builds his rock upon that good confession, not upon Peter, because Peter, though given the name Cephas or rock, is not a rock. He's made one by the converting work of the Holy Spirit and made one over time. As he's being sanctified, he turns into this wonderful apostle who at first denies Jesus three times on the night of his betrayal and later would rather die than deny him. See, that's the testimony that's there. Look at what Jesus says in verse 50. Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. Now, that's true. We've seen great work in the last 2,000 years. The church has done great work as empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's always through the work of the Holy Spirit. It's always by his power. You and I are without power, but by the power of the Spirit, we can do great things. The great things that the Holy Spirit intends for us to do. Then he says this in verse 51, truly, truly. And what's funny about that is in the original language, it's really amen, amen. Jesus puts the amens in the front. He puts the amen up front because he's saying, surely this is true because I'm saying it. So it's really amen, amen. I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on, and his favorite title for himself, the Son of Man. In other words, this is heaven. This is a place where angels descend and ascend as me, to me, because I am the King of heaven. I am the King of the world. I am the Messiah. I came as King. So he says, look, the church is going to do great things. Even today, the church is going to do great things. We have a baptism in second service. The Holy Spirit is still moving. He is still adding such as should be saved. He's adding people to the role of the redeemed. He's saving souls from condemnation and bringing them to true and saving faith. So if you take the things that are in here, you start off with follow me, and then you deal with the questions. When it says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? The question is, could this truly be God working? And of course, the answer is, this is how God is working, through his Son. God has determined to bring to himself a holy people. And those holy people are called Christians, followers of Christ, disciples of Jesus. So yes, the greatest good that ever came to mankind came out of Nazareth. And when you see Jesus saying, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man, what he's saying is, I'm the point at which all this takes place. Imagine, if you will, being in the scenes of heaven during some of the life of Jesus. Imagine being in heaven when Jesus is being tempted of the devil. Do you think the angels weren't leaning in going, can we go get him now? Can we fix Lucifer up for this betrayal? Can we go and take care of this problem that's been with us for a while now? Imagine at the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus, as men sit there and wag their heads at him, that all of heaven isn't leaned in, going, how long must we tolerate? You remember what the Bible says, the angels look in on this salvation of you and me, and they look at it, and there's a certain sense in which they don't understand. Why redeem this group? Why save them? And the answer God gives them is because I love them. They are mine everlastingly. They are mine because I have come to save them. So this saving work, this work where you see angels descending and ascending is based upon the fact that this is their king, this Son of Man. Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened. Now you'll see that at his baptism, don't you? At his baptism, the heavens open. The Holy Spirit descends and the Father speaks. You have the whole of the Trinity right there. I have some things written on my notes. I want to say these together, and I want you to hear them. Jesus says, follow me. Philip says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? And then Jesus says, truly, truly. He's putting what he says over against what Nathaniel says, or what Philip says. I'm sorry, Nathaniel. Nathaniel says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? What Jesus says is, the testimony of time and of the scriptures is that I am heaven come down. I am the Son of Man, his favorite title for himself, because that beckons back to Daniel, that case where you see this Son of Man walking in with the men that the fire could not consume. You and I would be consumed by the fire of God's judgment if it were not for the Lord Jesus Christ, if it weren't for the fact that he came and he says to you today, follow me. Don't give concern as to where I'm going. Just know that wherever I'm going, that's the place you want to be. Right? I guess the place I want to leave off, church, is I want you to think about this. Because I think one of the biggest problems in the church today is people have forgotten that real Christianity is a giving over of myself. Then when Jesus says, follow me, I drop everything I'm doing and I follow him. I don't give concern and say, well, now Lord, let me manage these things and then I'll come. When it's more convenient, then I'll come. That's not Christianity. Real Christianity is, well, I was a fisherman, and if I drop these nets, I give away everything I was to follow you. And Jesus, without blinking, yes. He calls us to something more. He calls us to follow after him. And it is a glorious opportunity. With that, I'll ask if you would bow your head. Father, the call is still going out. The call is still going out for men and women and children that they would follow after Jesus, that they would follow him wherever he goes without concern, knowing that wherever he goes is greater than where we would have gone without him. I pray that you would burn into our souls this glorious truth, this blessed truth that is, the following of Jesus is the best thing that's ever happened. It does come with a cost, but its cost is so low compared to what the cost is for not following. Forgive us, Lord, for those places where we've thought that we've taken the lead and that you should follow us, the master after the servant. But I pray, God, that we would not only diligently but gloriously and with great contentment follow after the Lord Jesus wherever he takes us. I ask God your blessing upon your church, on every family of Walnut Grove, that they would have grace and mercy in which to walk, and they have it in the name of the Lord Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Could you dismiss it, brother?
Father, thank you once again for this.